Tonight.
You are listening to the Doug Stanhope Podcast.
The potato peelings in the sink did not turn into vodka as I had hoped. I only start to need a drink after the liquor stores have closed. I heard you change your name again, but don't you change your hair. It was the only thing I liked about you in the end. La la la.
What?
Tell me when we start.
Oh, you were always talking. We're always on, so keep that microphone near your head.
Okay, all right.
And this podcast is not over. People listening, the podcast is over when the Mattoid plays Party Time, because too many times we go, all right, that's it, I think we got enough, that's the podcast, and then we pause and then we start talking again and it ends up 20 minutes longer. So I don't know if people shut it off going, hey, you said it was over. No, wait till, because we might get fucked up after this podcast. Yeah. And want to do another 20 minutes of drunk stupidity. So right. People, yeah, it's not over until you hear the Mattoid sing Party Time. Look up some other Mattoid shit. Mattoid's got fucking great stuff on YouTube. Google search the Mattoid Love Boat. He does a cover of the Love Boat theme song. That's fucking great. It's a video.
He also does Lionel Richie.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, and Dance and Queen.
And I like Funeral Pyre.
Yeah, Funeral Party.
Funeral Party?
Yeah. And Mishka's got some of my favorite songs ever. Mishka Shubali, who opens the podcast.
Oh, I know. I started a podcast right around the same time you did, and it turned out we chose the same song accidentally.
No shit?
Yeah, because I was like, man, this would be a good song to start on. And so then I was like, oh, Doug's got a podcast now. And I listened to it. I'm like, that's the same goddamn song.
Well, it was between that or the other one, which is the best opening line of all time, is the potato peelings
right,
in the sink.
Exactly.
So
I know. I love that album.
Which is now the opener.
Is that what we use now?
Yeah.
I know. I don't listen to my podcast, yeah. People.
It's only been 4 months.
Not a fan. Not a fan. Can someone keep James Inman here in a hard cider? Will you order him another hard cider?
Oh, God.
Get him two.
Yeah, might as well get... Bingo, can you go grab, just grab, four of them. Because the crowd's going to start filling up in there, and we don't want to open the door.
If they got a six barrel, just wheel it back here.
Is it only on tap?
Well, here, it is only on tap.
Okay, that's fine. All right. Yeah, James Inman is here with me in Kansas City. Pre-show, a fucking 7 o'clock show. It just doesn't seem right.
Is it really start at 7?
Yeah,
or are they just trying
7.
To get people in early?
No, it's improv. They don't
fuck
around.
That's a 7 o'clock show.
People that want to leave.
Don't you have
I've always said that. That's the problem with the improvs, is there's no Mr. Improv that's counting the receipts in the back afterwards. No one here gives a fuck if the club makes money. So they want to get it started, get the fuck out, get their tips. I don't blame them.
Yeah, but... Can't you ask him for some kind of green?
If you're working for the guy, if you're that guy that's making the money is in the room, he wants to make people wait and drink, and he doesn't want the show to start till 2 hours late, and he wants you to go long and fuck off because that's more drinks in the till.
Yeah, but you're like a rock star now, so you can order stuff for your green room, like jelly beans or But what you do
I'm
is...
I'm talking about the quality of the show. I'm not talking about me. I'm saying that. Yeah,
right. Oh, I thought
tabs
are
going down at 35 minutes in. They want people to get the fuck out.
Yeah, but can't you tell them not to do that?
I do to an extent, yes. Yeah. But I also don't want the fucking staff to hate me.
Yeah. Well, you got fired from the improv years ago, didn't you?
There's a gray area.
They canceled a date. I think, didn't they cancel a date?
They canceled some dates, and you don't really know. Again, because you don't know who the guy is. You don't know who Mr. Improv is. Yeah. So you hear a lot of stuff, and then it gets filtered through your management, and they soft touch it. And
yeah, I know. Well, they rarely book me, but they have my bio and headshot still on their goddamn website. So if you type in James Inman into Google, you'll get improv. Here's one of the comics that plays here. I'm like, you guys never fucking book me. What do you got my bio on your goddamn website for?
Who does book you anymore, James?
I don't know. Fucking, I book myself and I use a fake name. That's how I get bookings.
Do you still work for the creepy guy here in Kansas City?
I did a while ago, but I didn't.
Stanford and Sons.
It left a bad taste in my mouth, so I haven't really been there. But they're moving out of the place and going across, or on Broadway. He's moving because the rent went up or something. I don't know. But last time I went out and did something with Brett. He had a fucking it was a country club.
That was James Inman. James Inman is he's legendary in the business. You started here in Kansas City, then moved to Seattle, basically made a name for you. Or that's where I met you, was in Seattle.
No, we met in Vail.
All right, but I mean, you were in Seattle at that time.
Yeah.
And you would just legendarily go up and we'd feed you shots on purpose before you'd go up because we know you'd fucking break down and lay on your back and kick and scream about the fucking, you know,
something,
all this socialist shit and killing the landlords. I remember the first time I worked with you in Little Rock, Arkansas.
I know.
We had to stay on some in the owner's condo with the owner. And you were fighting with your wife at the time on the phone, screaming and yelling because your landlord had deemed it necessary for you to pay the rent.
It was something like we're day late and she fucking...
No, you were weeks or months late.
It was Christmas Eve and she called me for the rent. I'm like, bitch, it's Christmas Eve.
It wasn't Christmas Eve.
Yes, it was. She called me on Christmas Eve once for the rent.
Oh, once.
Yeah.
I was going to say, I wouldn't spend it. I've had some bad times in this life, but I was never spending a fucking Christmas Eve in Little Rock, Arkansas.
Yeah, but that's when I realized you were fucking with my head because we got in some argument about, I don't know what it was, but it was like racism or something. And you're like, I don't see anything wrong with the Ku Klux Klan. And I was like, what the fuck are you talking about? And you
but just it's kept so baiting easy me, to wind you up like that. And you'd believe it every time.
I didn't know that you were fucking with me. And it's just like constant with you. It's like constantly, what can we do to fuck with James Inman? It's endless. And all your friends are like, hey, Doug fucks with James. Let's fuck with him too. It must be cool to fuck with James. And so then I got all your fucking fans that are constantly pranking me and doing all kinds of shit. It's driving me crazy.
But you're so ripe for it. I mean, in Little Rock, you were yelling at your wife, not at her, but on her behalf. Because the landlord was asking for the rent, which you were like so late that you go, how do people get away with that? Because, yeah, I'm a week late on a fucking gas bill as a decent customer. They shut my shit off. I go, get the
note. There's a procedure, though, where people who know how to game the system go, look, if we're here for a certain amount of time, it's going to take them 2 years to get rid of me.
And if anyone knows how to game the system, it was Inman.
In Seattle, no. I blame my ex-wife because it turned me on to Marx, but I'm not really
Karl
a socialist.
Marx?
He would live with no electricity for months.
I had my electricity turned off one time, all right? And that was just to see what it was
you
like.
You lived in like a Buddhist monastery just because it was free?
That is not true. I went to a Buddhist monastery because I was studying Buddhism and I wanted to meditate.
And you happened to be homeless at the time.
Well,
so it worked
out. No, I wanted to. No, it wasn't technically. It was in between couches. All right. So I was like, fuck it. I'm going on a spiritual quest. So I went to a Buddhist monastery. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
You got anything wrong with that?
No, Mr. it's Atheist? Just, it was, again, one of those perfectly timed things where I was kind of homeless as this story, as he was
I
telling.
I took something that sucked and turned it into lemonade.
Well, right. How is your explanation of what happened different from what Doug said?
Because he always spins it to where I'm the fuck up.
Oh, he cut to the chase. Yeah.
No.
Got it.
No, he exaggerates how fucked up
I'd like
my
to
life
see
is.
How that ended. Like what? The Buddhist monastery thing, where they like, how do Buddhists tell James Inman, like, you got to get the fuck out?
bald guys in gold robes throwing his few possessions out the second story window.
That sucked, man. That was 2 months of not jacking off. It was like, oh my God. It was hard. It was fucking. Finally, I mean, it was really, really weird when I finally got back into normal society. I couldn't deal with shit.
See, I don't think you've ever been part of normal society, because we're talking 20 years back, and your life is not that much different.
Right.
You've just been kind of a wandering...
Right. Yeah.
Vagabond.
Well, don't we all wander? What do you mean? Who doesn't wander in life? We're all, like, born, and we wander around on the planet, and then we fucking die. I mean, it's not like you actually think you know where you're going. I mean...
I'm just saying, like, when this... We knew each other in those kind of situations. We were younger men.
Mm-hmm.
We were young guys. And it's a whole lot different living on someone's couch or in their carport when you're 28 than it is now that we're... Well, you're lived, over 50 now,
I lived
right?
in Randy's closet for a year and a half.
It was
a big closet, but it was big enough to put a bed in there. And that's the only... The whole bed took up the entire closet. So you walk in my room, there you're on the bed.
That's why I think it's kind of fantastic and horrifying that you've never really changed.
Sounds more like a swingers sex dungeon.
Yeah, it was. It was
wall-to-wall mattress.
I remember Inman and I think we were working in either Portland or Seattle, and you were doing the San Francisco comedy competition.
Right, uh-huh.
So you had done the first week, mm-hmm. and you moved on, but the second, there are two preliminary weeks. So you had that middle... The second week off, you were coming up to work with me.
Right. Or I was working the week after you at Harvey's.
Either way, you had the week off, so you're coming up. You're going to take the Greyhound bus after the last night in Sacramento, California.
Uh-huh. And oh, fuck. You're going to tell this story?
I was kind of leading you into it.
So I... what the fuck?
Well, you get on the bus, and they said you couldn't get on the bus because you're drunk.
I was going to Portland. I was on the bus.
Sacramento to Portland.
No. It was kind of like I was coming up from L.A. or something, and the bus stopped in Sacramento, and they said I had a five-hour layover. So I'm like, fuck it. I'm going to go get something to drink. So I got a bottle of gin, and I started drinking it. And I wasn't too drunk. I was just standing in line. I mean, I could function. But the guy smelled my breath, and he's like, sorry, sir, can't let you on the bus. Your breath smells like alcohol. I'm like, fuck, the entire bus smells like a heated turd. Who gives a fuck? It's a goddamn bus. It's not like you're flying a plane, you know? And he's like, sorry, can't let you on. And whatever, they kicked me out, right?
And it's the last bus of the night.
It was the last bus of the night, and so that's when I realized, oh, fuck, I'm going to have to, well, I didn't have money for a hotel, so I'm like, I'm going to have to sleep on the fucking street. So
wait, you're missing a part.
What?
Because you figure, hey, fuck it, I'm stuck out all night. I might as well go get another bottle.
Oh, right.
But you go to a liquor store.
Yeah, uh-huh, yes.
So you finished the first bottle of gin.
Right. So I had like $20 left. And I go in to buy another bottle of beer. And the guy goes, sorry, sir, I can't sell you alcohol. I'm like, why? He goes, because you're homeless. I'm like, I'm not homeless. I just got kicked off the bus. This is how I dress. I dress this way. Like, I'm, you know, like, fuck it, you know. So
then he had to tap beer outside like a 16-year-old.
No. So then I see this guy walking down the street who looked normal. I didn't know he was homeless because he was dressed nice.
Nicer than you.
Dude, here's 20 bucks. Go inside and buy some booze. And, you know, and we'll drink or whatever. He goes in and buys a goddamn fucking Slim Jim and takes off running with my $20. And I'm like, that was my last $20. And so, like, I'm fucked.
So now you have no alcohol.
Now I have no alcohol, no money. And I'm on the fucking street. And so I went up to another homeless guy. I go, where the fuck do you guys sleep around here? Ooh, we sleep in the park. I go to the park. The park is being resodded. So it's just dirt. So I slept in an unsodded park on the fucking dirt and rocks.
Fluffy dirt.
Yeah, it was fucking dirt. So I woke up, you know, I'm like, fuck this.
Wait, no, you...
Oh, yeah, I couldn't find a bathroom.
Wait, no, you're sleeping in the park, and then the cops approach you.
Right, and they say, they go, I go, okay, you can sleep here, but I just want to tell you that there's a guy on the loose in the neighborhood, and he's stabbing homeless people.
A massive homeless.
You see a guy with a green shirt on, you know, that looks like this, give us a call. I'm like, I don't have a phone. Anyway, so I'm sitting there going, I'm going to get stabbed in the fucking park because I got kicked off the goddamn bus. I was not homeless. I got kicked out of the bus station.
If you were homeless, it was for hours.
It was enough hours that when he went to take his shit, oh, they considered him homeless because that's customers only. And if you're not a customer, you don't have money to be a customer. You're homeless. So when he couldn't take a shit in any of the local establishments.
Theoretically, you did buy the Slim Jim.
No, I was broke. And so I went to this gas station and I said, can I use your bathroom? He goes, no, you have to buy something before you use our bathroom. I'm like, fuck it. So I went back outside. I couldn't find a place to take a dump, so I fucking shit on the sidewalk. And I was like, well, if I'm going to shit on the sidewalk, I went up in front of a Masonic temple, and I took a dump right in front of the goddamn Masonic temple.
Because the Freemasons secretly control the world, and he really wanted to make a political statement.
Quite a commentary.
And wipe my ass on a thrifty nickel. So... And then I found out later that the Freemasons are actually pretty cool.
And you know what? You ended up winning the San Francisco comedy competition.
Oh, yeah, I did, yeah. And then, yeah, I had some money for a little while.
Not very, very long.
No. Ex-wife spent it all. So.
Did you ever have, like, a good-paying job?
Yeah, before I got into comedy, I worked at a factory. Yeah,
I can't imagine a flush Inman.
Dude, I used to...
Yeah. Like the drinks for all my friends brand of Inman.
He's looked like this outfit from the Kenworth hat to the...
He swears roots. That's the same Kenworth hat that he's had for 20-some years.
I bought it. I got Asperger's or something. I have to have the same clothes or I...
Why do you have to have something to be sensible with your clothing choices?
Because I'm just stuck. It's like a good luck charm or something.
Well, then why do you blame it on some kind of a disease? I don't get it.
I don't know. My girlfriend told me...
An affliction, I'm sorry.
I was told I was diagnosed with Asperger's or something.
Didn't I have to mail that hat back to you from somewhere?
Yes, I left it at your party because I was out there and I fucking left my hat somehow.
I probably was holding it.
Hostage
as a security deposit.
You guys were hiding my goddamn chewing tobacco, and I started going, "Who's hiding my chewing tobacco?" And everyone's like, "Quit bitching, James. You're stupid. No, you're a paranoid freak. That's it. Nobody's hiding your chewing tobacco." The whole week I couldn't find it. And at the end of the week, you know what? Meat Sticks goes, "Yeah, James, we've been hiding your chewing tobacco." Yeah, so you were lying.
But you were coming after me. First of all, James Inman comes down for the... Was it 4th of July? Jesus. It had to be 4th of July. It was summer.
No. Yes, it was.
It was summer,
4th
yeah.
of July.
So James comes down. He's like, "I'm going to make it to your Super Bowl party. I found a cheap ticket." He shows up with a one-way ticket. Thinking that he's going to sell Vicodin out of his pocket. He had like spare Vicodin in his...
No, it wasn't.
In his pocket lint. And he goes, "Well, I figured I'd just sell these and get a bus ticket back." He goes, "There's no bus. There's no Greyhound
back
bus.
Back to Kansas City from Bisbee?"
Yeah.
I don't know. I thought you wanted me to come or something.
I did like want you to come, but...
Like, "James, just get here." And I'm like, "All right, I'll just fucking get there and I'll figure out how I'm going to get back when I get there." I didn't have a plan where I was going to sell drugs to fucking leave your, you know, I don't know. Just, I don't plan shit out.
You don't plan shit out.
Yeah.
You just
realize everyone who went to that party bought round trip tickets?
Those are smart people. Just
letting you know. Just taking a temperature of the room.
It's overrated to be planning shit all the time. You know, I don't think you really have to fucking look ahead. I mean, it's like, who knows what's going to happen in the future anyway? You don't know the future. You don't know what's going to happen, so fuck it. Why plan shit?
Why plan shit? I'll just show up there, and eventually, if they want me to not be there, they'll have to move me.
You know, I can easily make fun of you. I have a Doug Stanhope story. I always thought this was funny. When you lived in L.A. before you were famous, or somewhat famous, I go stay at your place, right? Because I had to do an audition somewhere, and I get in your apartment, and there's no fucking computer. This is right when computers first start coming out. I'm like, Doug, why don't you have a computer? He's like, oh, I don't need one. I'm like, dude, you can send email. And he goes, I don't need to send email. You know, and so I'm like, I'm sitting there thinking, how can I convince him? Dude, you can fucking look up conspiracy shit online. Why don't you get a goddamn computer? I read books. I'll buy a book or something. I'm like, so I'm sitting there going, wait a second. You can steal music off of Napster. Get a fucking computer. You can download free music. I don't listen to music that much. And I'm sitting there going, what can I say that'll make him get a fucking computer? And then I realized, you can get dog porn. A fucking video of a woman fucking a dog. And Doug goes, really? I'm like, yes. And so next time I stayed at his house, he had a fucking computer. It was like doing all that shit.
Oh, that was another time I had to fly back home.
No, that's... I know.
I remember I was dating a girl that was Christine Hodge from Head of the Class, and she had gone out. She was like, she would like just absolutely rape the premiere parties and stuff like that. She'd go to all these premiere parties, and then at the end, she'd go, hey, are you going to... you gonna throw away that shrimp? She just take all his shit. Well, one night she got visibly drunk. She wasn't a drinker and stole a bottle of Jim Beam from behind the
bar. Yeah.
And it made the gossip page in the L.A. Times. It said, a B-level actress, didn't say her name, was spotted klepting a bottle of Jim Beam. And so I cut that out and I put it on the bottle of Jim Beam, which she gave to me because she doesn't really drink. And I had that sitting up on a mantelpiece, and an Inman comes to stay with me, and I wake up and that thing is like one quarter.
No way.
Yeah.
Are you serious? No.
Yeah. You drank my fucking trophy.
I don't remember that. No.
Of course you don't remember it. You drank three quarters of a bottle of Jim Beam.
No, I wouldn't remember.
I don't even know what you were spiraling out for that time, but you were. I think you had come out to stay with someone else, and you guys got into a big alcoholic fight. Like, shut up, little man. The two of you.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you had to come stay at my place.
It's a long story, but yeah, I just don't like L.A. That's what you moved down there. I didn't move down there. I stayed in Seattle. So.
But,
and now you don't like it. You moved to Bisbee.
Yeah, I'm not saying you should have stayed. I'm trying to remember the circumstances where I had to come pick you up at someone's house because he was going to call the cops or
It was a comic friend of mine from Kansas City. He's like, dude, you got to get down to L.A. You got to come down here. It's cool. And so I'm like, I don't have the money. He goes, dude, just fly down here. I'll buy your ticket back. So I was like, cool. So I fly down there. And we get in an argument. He's like, get out of my apartment. I'm like, fuck it. Whatever. And now I'm like, thanks, dude. You fucked me. I flew down here. You said you're going to buy my ticket back.
Now you're being walked out by security again.
No, he was a goddamn pothead. It's a long story.
Chaille and I were talking about the last time you played Coots, which up in Anchorage. God. You have a couple of legendary stories in Anchorage.
Not only the last time he played Coots, the last time he will ever perform at Coots.
Do you want? I told you the exact fucking story of what happened, and you always turn it around like I'm the asshole. You know?
No, I don't say you're the asshole.
Did I ever tell you the exact story of what exactly happened?
You told me your version.
Tell me.
Doug's heard parts of my story, but
my
go ahead.
Version.
Let me hear your version.
Okay, first of all. Jesus, I don't know. Whatever I say, you're not going to believe me.
No, I
Chilkoot Charlie's is like the biggest bar in Alaska. It's monstrous. We've talked
43
about
years
it.
Old.
Listen
yeah.
to the podcast. We've talked about all it. Right. So Greg Chaille here. He
manages or books it.
And he would book the comics
book
up
the
there.
Comics, yeah. Okay, so all right. So I'm there with Jessica. Remember Messica?
Yeah.
Right. She was just happened to be in Alaska at the same time, and she came and she's like, "Oh, I want to watch your show." I'm like,
"She worked
right.
for fisheries, I believe, fishing right, games. Right. She did some stuff."
So she was there, and we were both drinking at the show. I wasn't drunk. I wasn't obnoxious, and it was one of those things where you know she buys a shot or let's do a shot. So I drink this shot. You know how sometimes it goes down your throat wrong, and I was like, "Oh, I got to throw up." So there was this giant trash can, not behind the bar, over you know just three feet away, I go over to the trash can and just kind of went blah like that. And I'm like, oh, okay, I'm all right. This bouncer sees me and he goes, come here. I'm like, what? He goes, we got to kick you out because if you throw up in the bar, you're kicked out. I'm like, all right, cool. So I follow him out. There was no violence. I wasn't being a dick. I get outside and I realize I'm kicked out of the bar because I threw up in the trash can.
James Inman is a 50-something-year-old long-term alcoholic.
I wasn't 50.
Don't think he's like some fucking pipsqueak girl at a bachelorette
right,
party
right.
that didn't expect that alcohol to taste so harsh.
Right.
And no, so anyway. You don't puke when you're not drunk.
It was a small puke. All right. All right.
Finally, you're calling it puke.
Right. All right. So it
here,
was.
You want some more?
I can't. Here, put that right there.
All right. That's yours.
Because I've got to move my hand around.
Let him
I
finish
talk.
The story.
I thought he was reaching for a beer.
All right.
I'm sorry.
So here's the deal. So I'm a nice person. I don't become a dick until someone really becomes a dick to me. All right. So I was like, okay, cool. I threw up in the bar. The rule is you get kicked out if you're, you know, if you throw up in the bar. So I'm outside. It's freezing fucking cold.
Not exactly a fucking, you know, Stalinist Russia kind of rule. You vomit in the bar.
Seems
you
sensible.
Probably should go.
Seems
right,
sensible.
Go ahead. So they walk you out.
The guy, the bouncer walks me out, and I go, you know that girl I was with, could you tell her that I got kicked out of the bar so, you know, we can go somewhere else or I can walk her to her car or whatever, you know, she's there by herself not knowing why I got kicked out because she didn't see the whole thing transpire. And the guy looks me dead in the eye and goes, nope. I'm like, excuse me, what? I'm like, can you just tell her that you kicked me out of the bar, that girl that I was sitting with? He's like, nope, sorry, you're kicked out, don't have to do shit for you right now, I don't care, not my problem. And I'm looking at the guy. I'm like, really? And that's when I said, did you know that I'm actually the comedian here? I was on stage tonight. I'm going to do a show tomorrow and the next night. If you want me to be funny tomorrow, maybe you better go get that girl right now. If you don't fucking get that girl, I'm not going to be funny tomorrow. And so the guy, you see this look on his face like, okay. So he goes in, gets the girl, and brings her back out. You know, I actually pulled out my license. I go, here's my driver's license. You see that name right there, James Inman? That's on my driver's license. That's me. You want me to be funny? You fucking go get that girl right now.
Okay, I've wondered how this leads into you getting fired from ever performing there again.
Yeah. So I do the. So it gets back to the manager. And so the manager and everyone was there watching my show because they're freaking out that I was going to suck that night. This was Friday.
Keep in mind, I have comic friends that have had to be physically carried off of the stage for being so drunk that they didn't know that their show was done. That had to be, and they got booked back.
Right, right. Anyway, so this got back to the manager. Somehow this bouncer must have really said I was a dick or something. Anyway, the manager shows up and he's watching my show. He looks at me in the eye and he's like, you gonna have a good show tonight? I'm like, dude, don't worry about it. It's no big deal. I was just fucking with that guy. I wanted to get my girlfriend, but you know, whatever. I go on, I have a great show. He's like, oh, no problem. That's cool. And then the next day it was like, well, this is the last night. There wasn't very many reservations. There was only about 12 people in the audience. And I'd kind of been drinking pretty much all day long. I'm like, fuck it. I'm going to dress up like a clown, put on some makeup. I'm going to have the worst show I could possibly have. And so just because that guy pissed me off so much. And so I went on stage and I just started sucking. I started saying the most outrageous shit I could think of. And they were actually laughing, you know. And but it pissed off the manager because he knew I was doing, you know. I was dressed in a clown suit. I had my clown shoes on. I was drunk. I was just talking stupid shit. And they turned the mic off on me. And I'm like,
after how long?
About 10 minutes.
And they just said, show's over?
Yeah. But there was only about 12 people in the audience. I'm like, what does it matter? It's fucking 12 people.
So there's a lot more earlier in the week, and then the word of mouth spread?
Whatever. I'm not that famous. No, it was just a slow night. But anyway, I mean, I had
good shows. A slow Saturday.
I had good shows.
You had a good Wednesday, Thursday.
What was it? Thursday, Friday, Saturday?
By Saturday, the whole town knew it was afoot.
Back then, I think it was Tuesday through Saturday.
Yeah, I don't know. For some reason, I wasn't thinking, you know, Chaille books the club. It wasn't, like, on my brain, you know?
Okay, because
it's like,
the way I heard the end of the story when Chaille was talking to his gal pal or on the phone was security escorted you to the condo before they drove you immediately to the airport.
Well, I mean, yeah. After,
that's not because they don't like off, clown suits.
No, he turned off the microphone, and so then I ranted another 10 minutes about him turning off the microphone.
Lights off, too, and at
whatever.
One point, it was the man. If I can.
Yeah, go ahead.
Chaille's going to chime
You weren't
in.
There, though.
No, but I talked to everyone there. I was a manager there, so I got...
Right, you talked secondhand. You're getting it firsthand from me.
No, your version happened. I'm getting from you. Correct. But I'll tell you, there are enough people there.
Okay, yeah.
Listen, James.
All right, so what did you hear?
I booked you. I wanted you to be right.
Right.
Okay? But it wasn't...
We all want James to be right.
Okay, so tell me what
it's
you
not
heard.
What I heard. It's what every story was similar, was that you were on stage. And you threw it in the ditch. But during the day, you came into the bar.
Oh, right. I forgot about that.
Do you want to tell that?
Yeah.
I'll let you.
Jesus Christ. Fucking... All right, so...
The bar is open at about 10:30, 11 every day, 365 days of the year. The day bartenders, you've been a bar... Right. You've worked in bars before, right, James?
Yeah.
You've worked security. You know what that's like.
Yeah.
Working with day crew, working with day regulars.
Yeah, you're right. I know exactly what it's like
to be
a bouncer. And when I was a bouncer, I wasn't a fucking cunt like that guy.
Well, all right,
we're
past
about that.
We're past
all right.
That.
No one's arguing that security at Coots has a whole fucking flock of cunts.
All right, it turns out the first night I was there, there's this girl there, and... Do I have to fucking...
No,
Brenda's in the room. Do I have to tell the story? Do you want me to...
Did you
know that I got laid in Alaska? Okay, all right.
I didn't ask you to say anything.
All right, so...
That wasn't coming up anywhere.
Shit. I didn't even know
that
about
was
that.
The biggest
all right,
fucking...
So, all right, here's the deal. I get there, I do the first show, this hot chick comes
Does
up.
Does Brenda have to know that I had my whole hand in my own ass in the condo? That wasn't where we were going, James.
Then you want the story. So, the first night, I meet this girl, she's hot, we end up fucking, all right? Second night, Jessica comes... Can you edit out her name, by the way?
Wait
Second,
a minute. What? This is almost a different story.
What are you talking
you
about?
You said Messica was the...
Let him go.
All right.
I'm just... Now
Messica came into town the very next night, and I fucked her, all right? So that day, I walk into the bar during the day, and I was like walking on air, feeling like I was this fucking god, because I just fucked two girls that week, and I was happy. I had a smile on my face. I was happy. I wanted to drink at the bar, right? I walk in there with this huge smile, being nice and happy, and I order a drink with this fucking, just a bartender that had a perpetual frown on her face, who seemed like she was pissed at life her whole life, and she sees me happy. I order a drink. I sit down, and I go... I can't believe it. This is a crazy, crazy week. I fucked two women already this week. I mean, it's just, I said
You
that.
Said this to her?
I don't know. Yes, I said something like, I fucked two women this week. I can't believe it. I don't know why I said it. I just said it, all right? And so she gives me this look like, get out. Like, basically, you're not welcome here. And she took my drink away. And I'm like, oh, my God, this woman's a cunt. I'm sorry I told you that I fucked two people this week. And I just, like, fuck it. I think I called her a cunt, and I just walked out.
You called both of the girls a cunt that were there. One of them checks the ID at the door. The other one,
whatever.
Catherine, who's closer to a MILF than a perpetual sad
I called
face.
The bartender a cunt. Yeah.
Correct.
Right.
Was the quote not, didn't save it for your act if you're working
and they
on
said,
the material?
Yeah, what you came, I think what they thought you were doing, James, I mean, in your defense, they thought you were probably trying to be funny with the, I got laid twice, I'm walking on air.
And it, look, let's get this out in the open. The girl's a dyke, all right? She's a fucking lesbian.
Who?
The bartender. You could, just the way her fucking hair was cut, she looked like she could bench 300 pounds. She had fucking dyke fucking tattoos. She was a lesbian. She doesn't want men to be happy. I came in there. I was happy. I had the smell of pussy on my face. It just pissed her off. Okay? And when she goes, you fucked two women. You know, you're an asshole. Took my drink away. And I'm like, fuck it. You're a cunt.
See,
and I walked out.
Was that your first drink of the day?
Probably not.
No.
So what?
You had finished a bottle of wine before you came in.
Yes, but I generally don't drink before my show.
Or a bottle of wine before noon.
After, look. Here's where I lost.
This is why it's never Inman's fault.
Here's where I lost respect is when that fucking bouncer kicked me out and he wouldn't go in and get my girlfriend. I mean, it's just a danger thing. It's like, how is she going to walk home? I mean, it's
yeah.
Messica. I mean, she's in a bar by herself. You know
but
what I mean?
But he did go in and get her, though.
After I told him who I was.
All right. But
this is a girl that...
Tell me that is not a cunt thing to do. Tell me that is probably on a fucking list.
After someone
fucking
vomits?
Asshole shit.
But wait a minute.
I vomited in a trash can.
Okay, but you understand that he did eventually go and get her for
after
you.
After I told him who I was. After I threatened to have a shitty show.
And by the way, it was more of, do you know who I am?
No,
that's
no,
my
no.
Name.
See, you just said it. You spin it. You try to spin it that way.
You just said it. You pulled your
after his, look,
your ID out of your wallet
oh, no. See,
and
this
pointed.
This is where you're fucking with me again.
You just did.
This is,
you just
no.
Said it. Do you want me to play the tape?
Which
back?
Is more of a cunt thing to do? Kicking someone out of the bar who wasn't really drunk or fighting or violent. And when the guy goes, can you tell my girlfriend that you kicked me out of the bar so she can come out and we can go somewhere else? And he goes, no. Which is a bigger dick thing to do. That is a big fucking dick thing to do.
That's a
and
dick thing
dangerous.
To do.
And Messica could, who knows
dangerous.
What could have happened
that girl,
to her.
First of all, Messica was up there working on the fucking fishing boat.
Yeah.
Like the most dangerous job in the world. She ain't no fucking...
Oh, well,
see, you're wallflower.
Yeah, you're just wilding me. Like, let's wind James up or, yeah. So I pull out my driver's license. I go, this is me. I'm the comedian. Can you please go in and get... my girlfriend, because I'm going to have a bad, bad show tomorrow if you don't go get her.
So they did. So they shut off the mic. This is the last night. It's
last
Saturday.
Night. Yeah. Last night. What happened was he went home when they kicked him out of the bar during the day. It was a Saturday.
Yeah.
And when he came back, he was in full clown garb. And this is, he was living behind the, he was.
Yeah.
But so he's a short walk.
Yeah, the condo's right behind the bar.
He comes walking over as the clown, comes gets on stage, and I didn't know that he had planned to trash it, like that was premeditated, but he basically went up and said, ask me a question. Ask me questions. And he had, now we know how many people were there because we have people take numbers at the door. There were 60 people in the room that night.
Oh, give me a break.
I know.
You,
how
all,
could 60 people be at one of your shows? I understand that. Right, I understand that.
When someone sees a fucking UFO, you know, most times people go, you're crazy. But when two or more people see a UFO, maybe there's more credibility or whatever.
James, we keep
listen,
track.
Listen,
they were obviously
James,
pissed
James.
At me. I was there. There was no fucking 60 people in that fucking room.
Not at
James,
the end.
I. This is the
not
reason.
The, end?
The,
yeah.
The reason he's my tour manager. Yeah. I get a hate mail, not hate mail, but a fan that was angry at the late start time of a show in Fargo, North Dakota. And I
Nestor
read him the
Tavern.
Email. She goes, and it was supposed to start at whatever. And we waited till whatever, and it never started. And we should get a refund.
Uh-huh.
And he goes into his book. He has the amount of time every comic did down to the minute. He has how many people
right.
were. He has
bad
every
you weren't
detail.
There that night, because then you would have known how many people were there.
Well, all right.
Which was, it was definitely not 60. I'll tell you this much. It wasn't 12. It was probably about 20.
Then don't say it's 12 next time, you fucking
whatever.
Liar.
So I'm exaggerating. I it's basically
okay.
The room is not full.
All right.
The room has got about 20 people in there.
But it's a Saturday night.
It was a... I apologize. I'm sorry. No,
James,
I fucking had
we're
a bad
just talking check. About this.
Okay.
When he went on stage, he said, okay. Ask me a question. And all he right. was really like laying it on thick. I want... Give me a question. And whatever, you know, it started with like, why are you a clown? And stuff like that. I was like, fuck you. You asked me a real question. And we've seen James do this. And that can be right. funny for a little bit. And the guy who was hosting and managing that night was a manager that had been there for a long
from
time.
Applebee's. He used to work at Applebee's.
Probably.
Probably, yeah.
Everyone's right. got a past, right?
Right.
So he knows comedy. He's going to, you know what, I'll let him go.
He also did stand up.
Yes. Yeah. And I'll let him go. We'll see where this is going, right? After about 10 minutes, it was just him doing that, and you hear the scooting back of chairs, and some people are leaving, right? So he...
No. Wait a second. First off, you weren't there.
No,
and no one fucking left.
I'm not saying
nobody
I was
even
there.
Walked out. Don't well, tell me you were not there. You're hearing a secondhand story
from at least five different people.
They hated me because I told the fucking
James.
I'm just trying to get to the point where from the transition from the stage.
All right, I'll do this really quick.
Of course, they're all gonna hate me. I call the bartender a cunt. They're gonna make up the fucking worst story.
Believe me,
we saw him fuck a bunny.
We're not. We're not that organized, kids. Right. We can't get people to agree on anything. So, listen, he's doing this thing where right. he's not going to give the mic away, which I think is hilarious that he's on stage with the big floppy shoes and everything, and they're doing this, like, trying to grab the mic, and he can't get it, and then they decide that they're going to turn off the power or turn off the
sound. Yeah,
they
turned the mic off.
And I think the lights went down for a little bit, and that's when James fell off the stage.
You fell off the stage?
Clown shoes up, yeah.
Oh, yeah, so you don't remember?
So then they're like, we got to kick you out, but first we're going to pay you. So they paid me.
For the full week?
Right, whatever. Yeah, well, okay. I would have took whatever money they gave.
No, I'm just saying, I don't want you to we still paid you, even though you really kind of ditched it that last night.
Yes.
For whatever reason.
Yeah.
Okay. And they.
So then what?
They paid me. I had my clown pants on. I put the money in my clown pants. And on the way back to the condo, it was slick as shit because it's Alaska. I fell down and the money went flying through the air. And I had to go walking around, running around in clown shoes trying to pick up 50s and $100 bills in the fucking breezing wind.
And? You might not remember this, but I'll remind you because Tracy, she told me today... The bouncers, one of them helped you gather the money.
One of the bouncers that was escorting you back to pack up your things so they could fly
you
the fuck out of Alaska.
That did not happen.
It's a detail that I would not have asked for.
I don't really care because, you know.
I'm just saying, there's not such malice there. If you got paid and the bounce staff was helping you get up there and then they drove you to the airport.
Yes, I am not. First of all, I'm not perfect.
That's why you have all good stories.
And sometimes I get mad at people, like that bartender pissed me off with her attitude. When someone's happy, you should be happy that they're happy.
Yeah, so if the bartender at 10:30 a.m. is not welcoming as you'd like, make sure that the audience at 8:45 p.m., that it was no part of it, pays the fucking price.
Yeah, save that full shot of vitriol for the late show.
Well, I mean, it's like I could just tell. I mean, I thought it was unfair for the bouncer. It's totally fair for a bouncer to follow the rules and kick someone out if they throw up in a trash can. That's the rules. And I was like, no problem with that. And then I was like, can you go in and tell that girl that I got kicked out because she doesn't know? And he goes, nope. I'm like, what? You can't be serious. That was like the height.
You keep going back to that, but the fact of the matter is
that's
you explained who you were, and then he did what you asked.
And that was two nights before.
Yeah. If I hadn't have explained who I was, he would have treated me just like a fucking loser.
This is the same James Inman that called me up after he had to go to jail for egging his neighbor's car.
Jail?
Yeah, my neighbor lived downstairs.
She used to play crime.
No, she played music in the morning, 6 in the morning, every morning. I had to listen to it. Finally, I put a note on her door. Could you please turn the music down? And she never did.
Or I'll egg your fucking car.
Yeah.
You chink
again.
Or something.
No. You want to hear that story? All right, I'll
Wait,
tell
this
you.
This is a different egging of a car.
I asked her to turn it down. She wouldn't turn it down, right?
Well, first of all, he has the perfect crime already in play where he leaves a note on her door saying that I'm going to egg your car
again
in apartment 6B.
Basically, yeah. I
put it in writing.
Yeah, I mean, I fucking egged her car. And
after she didn't turn it down, after he left a note,
no,
he
you're
followed
making,
through.
You're not letting me tell the story, okay. But she always had loud music. One day, I fucking just out of the blue egged her car. Then she never turned the music down, even when I asked her. And that's when I put the note on her door that said, if you don't turn your music down, I'm going to egg your car again. And that's when she said, oh, you've been the one egging my car. You're the one that egged my car. And she came up and knocked on the door with the note and said, did you put this on my door? I'm like, fuck yeah, you won't turn your music down at 6 a.m. And she had an accent. So it sounded like she's from Eastern Europe. And she's like going, you know, like that. I'm like, look, go the fuck back to your own goddamn country and play the music as loud as you want. But here in America, come on, you know, fucking I'm your neighbor. It's 6 a.m. And she took... go back to your own fucking country as a racist slur. Told the cops, and they came to my door, said, yeah, it's a hate crime. I'm like, hate crime? What are you talking about? All I said was, I can't remember the exact words, but basically it was like, maybe they play music at 6 a.m. really loud in your fucking country.
And he told me the story.
Yeah, and that became a hate crime.
He told me the story, and he says... And then I was in jail, and I don't have any money. All of his stories end with, I don't have any money. And so I had to call my dad for money to get me out of jail. And I go, would you get arrested for egging a car? Yeah. Don't they automatically call your parents?
Oh, see, half the time I don't really know if you guys are making fun of me or if you're just
We're
like,
having fun with you, sir.
With me, yeah. But you're never
I love you.
There when the shit really happens. It's fucked up.
I've been there when plenty of shit happened. I was there when you swore that I was had something to do with someone hiding your chewing tobacco.
Which, and it turned out I was right.
And you didn't know what house we were in my neighborhood, the quietest fucking neighborhood in the world. And it's 3 a.m.
Jesus
and
Christ.
Inman's just walking up and down these quiet, homey streets screaming, Stanhope! Where's one of those fucking dogs Stanhope living? I will go to every fucking door in the neighborhood.
What?
Yes. That's when you were trying to find us. We were at that other house.
It wasn't 3 a.m, Doug. It was like 5 or 6 a.m. because it was already light.
Whatever it was.
Because that's
we'd already had the police happened? Called on us at that other house.
We stopped playing at 3 a.m.
No, tell that story.
That's the one where you thought I was up to something that I wasn't. I was hosting a party for 45 people.
Right.
And you think that I'm
stealing
your
at the party. I was being nice. And some of the...
All the stories start with, I was at the party.
Minding my
drunk.
Own business.
I was being nice. I was polite to everyone. I put my fingers under the bartender's nose and go, guess who got fucking lucky? And she took my drink away.
I don't know. Okay, so. Hold on,
James. By the way, there's nothing wrong with the equipment. James has just put a golf ball size chew in his mouth. That's why it sounds a little different on the mic.
Okay, all right.
No, I just...
And, oh, by the way, everybody, Chaille talks really fast, so you might want to slow it down when he talks because you're too smart.
Yeah, that's really...
You talk too fast.
This is an inopportune moment to throw that hockey puck of chewing tobacco in your...
No, you can keep
ahead.
It in there. That's
go
the only reason I make
is,
that
this
distinction.
This is why I snapped at your party, okay? I'm being nice. I'm there. I make friends with everybody. I don't... Here's another thing about me. I don't talk behind people's backs, all right? I try not to say negative shit to someone until they really fuck me over, all right? So, it's like the third day of the party, I'm passed out on the couch, right? I wake up to the smell of some kind of fucking goddamn magic marker. I open my eyes, and there's a guy there standing there videotaping me. I'm like, what are you doing? And they're all laughing. Ha ha ha.
Yeah,
ha,
they do
ha.
Tend to get a little infantile with the pranks sometimes.
I go... What? And they're like, go in the mirror. I look in the mirror. The fucker drew a swastika on my forehead and painted a dick on my face, which is high school bullshit.
Yeah, that's true.
Kind of like egging a car.
Yeah, so I snap, and I probably that was probably wrong to do. And I'd never really gotten that mad in quite some time. And anyway, they found a way to get it off. They got turpentine, they put it on my face, and they're able to get the fucking swastika off my head. I didn't want to walk around your party with a fucking swastika on my head. That's what I thought. I thought it was going to be on there with a permanent marker, the whole party. There's James with the swastika on his forehead.
Then they showed him the magic of soap and water.
And so, no, it was turpentine. One girl came, and she's like, we know how to get it off. We use this. It smelled like gasoline or something.
Was that me and you or me and Renee? One of us had to bathe you in a bathtub once at the Death Valley.
That was in
Me and Renee had to fucking give
someone
you...
Someone took pictures. I've seen
we had to actually bathe you in a bathtub.
Well, so he's had one.
Yeah. So, anyway, I felt like, man, that was a really fucked up thing to do. This is what really pissed me off. No one would tell me who did it. Which made me feel like, oh, it wasn't really a prank. It was done out of real hatred and malice. Because if it was a prank, they'd go, yeah, it was that guy. Ha, ha, ha. No, everyone was keeping their mouth shut because they knew they were fucking doing it for real. Let's draw on James's face because we hate his guts. All right, so anyway, I finally, I knew that karma has a way of getting around, coming back.
I think the only one that ever worried that actually hated you, and he wasn't even at the party, was Norm Wilkerson used to, I think, take it way too seriously. Like, that's
he did that with
whole...
other comics, though, too. Him and Walsh had a thing.
But Norm is just a curmudgeon. I figured that's just his personality.
But that's kind of one of the romantic things about loving you for this many years.
You're always
such a colossal fuck-up that you just assume someone else is going to pay your way.
I don't assume people are going to pay my way.
That was the first conversation that when I was working with you in a Little Rock, staying, and you're yelling at your wife about the landlord, going, why does she want money from us? She's got everything. We have nothing. She has a brand new car.
You
couldn't understand why a landlord deserved any money from you.
That was back when I thought I was a socialist. God.
The first person they killed in the communist revolution were the fucking landlords.
Right, right. And that was stupid. I'm not a real socialist. I'm more of, I don't know what I am now, but you've inspired me. Most of my friends who are libertarians have inspired me. I'm also inspired by Nietzsche. I'm inspired by the Buddha. All of those philosophies are about pulling yourself up by your own bootstraps, all right? So I'm not a fucking socialist. I mean, I kind of am, but I'm not. I mean, I'm open-minded. All my friends are libertarians. I'm open. I'm like you. You're more of a comedian than you are a libertarian. But the thing with Norm is he's just a fucking curmudgeon. And so he hates everybody. So
anyway, I'm sorry. Yeah. I didn't mean to get you off track.
All right.
I just the people drawing swastikas on your head. And again, we've had some legendary parties in Death Valley where things do spiral fucking way out of control. No authority figures.
I overreacted and I felt really bad about it. But you freaked the fuck out too. One of those nights,
you
were on mushrooms and you grabbed my skull and you were gonna crush my skull for some reason.
Yeah,
Choking him?
Yeah, I thought it was choking you, but either way, it got to that point. That's when you were fucking wandering around my neighborhood, shrieking at the top of your lungs, tell me where Doug Stanhope lives. And like, Inman's gonna fucking have every neighbor out calling the cops.
I don't remember that.
Like,
we did have the cops
all the time.
Out earlier.
Yeah,
the cops did.
But then you would just, I forget what you were relentless about. Where you just couldn't see. It was just one simple argument where you just couldn't see the point of how rude it was to do whatever you were doing. And I'm going, no, this is... And then I snapped and grabbed you by the neck and I don't do that.
When you know that someone pranked me with the magic marker on the face, how come, since you like pranks so much... How come you didn't prank them back or find a way?
Inman, I was hosting a party that was in two different houses on different streets for 3 days, cooking food. I was last thing I'm doing is sitting up at 5:30 in the morning to see who's drawn on Inman's face.
Well, right, but I mean,
or in the afternoon or whenever it was.
Right.
You
well,
saw
anyway,
it.
I got the guy back because what happened was
who was it?
Well, I was doing something on YouTube and I see this video, James Inman. drunk. And I'm like, what the fuck is that? And it's the video of them after they drew on my face. The guy with the camera.
Who was it?
It was Joe Stats. That's who uploaded the video. I was like, motherfucker, now I know who you fucking are. And you're a guy that wants to do comedy. He's just starting out in comedy, right? So I go, I got a plan. I even emailed you about this. I go, dude, I'm going to buy joestats.com because it's available. I buy his domain name because he didn't have an email. You know, I mean, he didn't
Great
have a
prank.
Domain name.
Yep.
And I created this web page of him with a swastika on his face. And I put a bunch of racist shit on there and everything. I figured I'd
Did you do it?
Yes, dude. I left it up there for like a week. And then I just basically gave him the website. I said, here you go. You get a new website of this whole deal because I wanted to get you back for a week. And he's like, thanks, James. I'm like, yeah, I'm a nice person. You know, here's a fucking website. So now he's got a website. He fucking uploads shit. He's got his video on there. He's got his pictures and stuff.
See, James does good. By the end of the podcast, Inman did something right.
I mean, he's a nice guy. I mean, he's funny. I've seen his videos. I've seen his stand-up. Yeah, he's funny.
I could talk to you all night, James.
Are we?
Yeah, we're getting close. I got to check my notes. Banjo Randy is here. You wanted to have him play during the podcast.
He broke his banjo.
Oh, good, because we weren't going to do it anyway. Because if we needed to edit it, it makes it fucking impossible with music.
Okay.
So
all right.
Fuck that. But where do we find some good Banjo Randy? If you don't remember or don't know, if Banjo Randy played the intro and outro on Deadbeat Hero. So I love a banjo.
Yeah, and he's also
he's played
on
live the, with me on stage.
He's got two songs in the movie The Unbookables.
Oh yeah,
we didn't talk about The Unbookables.
That's right. Watch that movie.
The Unbookables was a touring idea at first, where I have a lot of friends that are fuck-ups and just... can't do anything except the funny part of comedy. They can't, you know, show up on time or at all, or they're fucked up, or they get arrested, or they have, you know, horrific, you know, legal issues or drug problems or drinking issues. Yeah. So the idea was to try to bring out, a dirty dozen kind of, what's another analogy?
Yeah,
I think you get the point.
Yeah, it's a road comedy
pack.
Movie.
So then I'm busy doing something, and Inman meets some producer, and he goes, I want to make a documentary out of The Unbookables, and this guy's going to do it. And I'm like, yeah, sure, I don't care.
Me and Norm Wilkerson pulled that off, because we didn't know if you were behind it or not, and I'm talking to Norm over the phone. I go, look, Doug's a libertarian. He wants us to do shit on our own. Let's just fucking make this movie. So me... Andy Andrus and Norm put that tour together, and that guy filmed the whole thing, and we did it because we wanted to fucking do something. And
when I said yes, Inman getting anything done, I just assume isn't going to happen. So I go, yes, go ahead, do whatever you got to do, James.
Yeah, and he finished it, didn't he?
Yes, he did. I was positive in thinking that it would never see the light of day. And I thought that's a good thing, which I still think would have been a good thing. They make you the fucking hero of the movie, where you're the...
They made fun of me the whole movie. What are you talking about?
Well, not the hero, but they make it look like you're the protagonist. Like, yeah. Thank you for the big word.
I didn't know that was going to happen.
But it's not a bad thing. It's just people don't understand. You're the fucking Perry of our Windy City Heat. The interview you just
Perfect.
Gave. Yes, who's Perry?
Don't worry. Don't worry.
Right. Yeah, but yeah, again, if you know the people in it, I enjoyed The Unbookables only like because I know everyone. I know the backstory. I know how the film got made.
You've toured
everybody
with
likes
every
Sean.
Single one of them.
Everyone likes Sean.
Yeah, Sean Rouse is fucking brilliant in it.
He has the best bit in that movie.
But it makes no sense. Like, as a comic, it bothers the shit out of me because it doesn't make any sense why this tour would all of a sudden not have some people but have new people and be here and there. And who's booking this? Mm-hmm. It doesn't make any fucking sense.
Yeah,
but one day, one day we'll redo it.
They're gonna re-edit the film.
It's no saving that thing. But go watch it on Netflix and see all
you
these
don't
people
like
we're
anything.
Talking about.
You didn't like my Greyhound Diary. You don't. You
what
don't
do you
stop,
mean I didn't? I love your Greyhound Diaries.
Yeah, you like it now, but when I first showed you the Greyhound Diary, you're like, "Eh, this is stupid." And I'm like, no, I'm going to turn it into this thing and then whatever. When you didn't think.
I've offered you nothing but positive.
After it came out, when you realized it was good, you know.
When I realized it existed.
No, listen, everybody, don't listen to Doug. Just watch the movie and make up your own mind.
Yeah. But now that they've heard you, they have a little bit more insight as to some of the people. They know Andy Andrews, who's in it.
Andy.
They might know Sean Rouse, who's in it. Christine Levine.
Christine.
Brendan Walsh.
Brendan Walsh. Brett Erickson. There for a minute. Brett Erickson.
Travis Lipsky.
Lipsky for another reason.
We made the movie for you, dog, because you created the Unbookables, so we figured here's our chance to make a movie, and we made a fucking movie.
You made the Unbookables unbrandable.
I gotta pee. Can I go?
Yeah, well, let's shut this down.
You can leave that here.
We're at the end of this 5-week fucking endless leg. We got 6 or 7 more shows to go. I wanted to thank. Get the mic in there.
You're not gonna use that, are you?
No, we're not rolling.
There's some minor health issues on this tour. They just keep piling up, but we've been lucky to find doctors in weird places. Dr. Jeremy last night in St. Louis for my new vernal hernia, ventral. Ventral. I'm just a fucking giant torso of hernia. And Dr. Joe with my fucking eye lumps. Thank you for helping out. Joby's got those new t-shirts up at the Deathpool website, Stanhope Celebrity Deathpool, DSCDP, Doug Stanhope Celebrity Deathpool, DSCDP.com. Get the new t-shirts, they're cool as shit, and
completely, stop it, turn it the fuck off, god damn it, god, you're mean.
Yeah, that's Inman seat, baby.
Yeah, I was just going
to, there's your cider.
Oh, cool.
I just put it in.
Okay, wait. So the Unbookables, I think it's not on Netflix.
No.
Okay, so I said it was. Well, you can. It's not on Netflix. Go out and find it. It lives in the.
It's on BitTorrent and it's on the website if you want to buy it on Unbookables, the UnbookablesMovie.com.
All right. Well, there's that. We fixed that. And JamesInman.com. James Inman has some really funny. You have a legendary old city council meeting that you spoke at. That's fucking genius.
Where he snapped at
the city council. James Inman City Council, you can find that. And then you just did a new one where, there's the one of you getting punched by a chick on stage.
That's at the Underground, right, in Seattle?
Yeah, the old comedy Underground.
I got punched on stage, yeah.
And then this new one he just did. I don't know if I showed Chaille. I told you about it. He's at his uncle's eulogy, funeral, giving a eulogy with his dad in the front row, talking about how much cooler his uncle was than his dad, pointing to his dad. Yeah, my dad bought us a skateboard, but Uncle Joe had 4-wheelers. That kind of shit. It's this brilliant fucking chunk of footage. But find all that at jamesinman.com. Is that all those clips on your site?
On my YouTube page, James Inman's YouTube page or whatever.
Yeah, all right. And you wanted to promote the
JLDS, Jesus Loves Doug Stanhope, which was a domain name that Norm bought, and he ran the forum for years. Then he gave it up, and now Little Mikey's running the goddamn thing.
All right, this is a lot of unnecessary information for the people. It's the forum link on my website. It goes to this forum, I abandoned years ago.
But you come around every now and then.
Like once every year or two, I'll brilliant. Stop it and go, wow, this thing still exists?
Doug, you have some smart fans. Some of your fans are brilliant. Private Prozac, Chinger, there's another guy on there that's a big Nietzsche fan.
I'm not saying that there's not brilliant people there. It's just once MySpace came and then fucking Facebook and now Twitter, and I'm 1,600 deep in unanswered emails.
But this is a place where
I can't get to all that shit.
This is a place where you can't get banned or booted. The only rule is don't post kiddie porn, and people let you post whatever you want. There's giant, huge arguments on there about.
I know. I'm just saying. I don't after the shit I have to do.
Yeah.
I don't have time
to
go.
Time to go there.
Yeah. My laptop is a sink full of dirty dishes that I just avoid getting to the stuff I have to do.
I know. Some of these guys are good writers.
It's no more fun. Like, the baiting shit. When I used to do the baiting, it would take like 14-hour days just to get one printable bait. And I go, like, how did I have that much fucking time?
How long did it
take? How did my life change so much that I...
How long did it take you to write that book, Best of Baiting?
Well, I was baiting for God knows how long.
And then,
and again, you do full days of that, just trying to get, you'd get a great one that went halfway and the guy caught on to the fact that you're fucking with him and he drops out.
Are
and
you then you're trying another book?
No, I'm not. If I ever have fucking 14-hour days to kill baiting again, dude, yeah, maybe I'll do a part two, but
you have some time off. You work, you know, one thing about you is you're a workaholic. You actually work on your act. I mean, Bingo told me that, oh yeah, he's out in the football room again, going over his act. You know, you actually work on your act.
Well, I have to, because people show up to see me now.
They want to see new material.
Yeah, they're not there. It's not like the old days when we started, where any asshole off the street is just coming in to see comedy. Right. Now I have to actually deliver for people who know me.
Right, right.
So, that's when comedy stopped being fun.
Yeah,
when you had to be good at it.
But you can do it in your sleep now. I mean, just about.
No. Actually, the older you get, the more feeble your brain gets. Bingo sits the back of every show, and anything that I riff off the top of my drunken head or add to a bit, she writes on a yellow legal pad.
I told Randy about your English monarchy bit. Are you going to do that tonight?
No.
Dude, did Brian Hennigan help you write that bit?
No.
Does he help you write any of your bits?
No, I mean, well, occasionally.
Isn't he the fucking
banter
best?
Back and forth? Like, well, what's a good way to say that? He's great for words, where you go, what's another word for this?
Yeah, but he's got a big vocabulary. He's probably the greatest manager on the face of the planet. You lucked out by meeting that guy. He's fucking amazing.
He's fucking great.
Yeah, I know. I love the guy, but he hates my guts. But
he hates everything.
Oh, he hates everything. Okay.
That's why we get along so good. We're both miserable, like, spiteful, sniping men.
Exactly. All right. What was the other thing we're?
I think that's it. Oh, you have a podcast.
Right, I have a podcast, Drunk Idiots Podcast. I got three of them up, but I've got seven of them in the can, and I haven't posted them yet. But I'm just, you know, I'm going to post one here pretty soon.
All right.
You know, so check that out. It's on my website.
All right. Yeah, find James Inman at being walked out the back door of a club near you.
Yes. All right. I'm sorry to Chilcoot Charlie's. Does that sound like a real apology?
You don't have to apologize.
Yeah. No one's upset about it.
No.
Do you know how bad a track record I have for every comic that I have suggested they book up there? I am about like 2 for 10.
You're 0 for 3 in the most recent.
In the recent, the 0 for 3.
So Rick
Shapiro fucking walked the house nightly. I don't think he made it through the week.
He made it. Well, part of the problem was also we had the person that was doing promotions at the time booked Rick Shapiro in a non-smoking room and thought that he wouldn't smoke. I mean, he sees the sign that says $250 and lights the match off of it. Oh. I mean, it's not. So that cost us a lot. We had to pay for the deposit on the room or whatever they do.
I didn't even think he smoked cigarettes.
It was, he did two shows and basically it was, hey, this isn't working. He goes, yeah, I don't think so either. And we paid him for the full week. And even Durant says, hey, stay at the condo that we got you in now. Stay for the week. He goes, nah, just go home. And they rebooked his flight and flew him out of there early.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've sent up. It's
doesn't work
it's
sometimes.
Not a good room for comics. And those are generally the guys I send. No, they'll do fine. Nope. Yeah, crickets. Crickets really, or walkouts.
Yeah, but I mean, you got to admit, I mean, Alaska has a whole different vibe than the lower fucking 49.
I remember Sean Rouse went up, and I called ahead of time. I go, because this bar is legendary. It's just a barrage of shots coming to the stage from the minute you walk up. Mm-hmm. And I called the bar, and I said, listen, Sean Rouse, you're not the guy you want to be giving shots to. don't give them shots. Oh, and they thought I was being sarcastic.
Oh, no.
Like, and...
Like a wink and a nod. Yeah. It's like, hey, don't send any shots to my buddy Rouse. Oh, yeah. It was ugly.
Yeah, he was one of the... They had to actually go up and tell him where he was and walk him off the stage by his elbows.
Well, so I don't feel so bad now. Sean Rouse got walked off the stage.
Well,
so
I didn't want you to not feel bad till the end of the podcast. I wanted you to feel bad the whole podcast and then let you down nice.
I'm not the comic that Sean is, so whatever.
Not many are. That's a podcast.
All right.
That's it.
I need to, before the show, I'm going to go bum a cigarette.
Yeah, they've already started seating the audience, so it's about time to break down.
All right.
All right, yeah. We're playing a lot of weird we played more shit towns on this tour than the shit town tour, but some fun ones. So if you live in some place that I'd never think to go but is actually cool, yeah, shoot an email with that town and the fucking name. Fayetteville, Arkansas, I would have never known as a cool fucking town. Hattiesburg, Mississippi, I would have never known. Even Mobile, Alabama, I would have. That was fun.
That was good.
Had some fun.
Hey, what about your...
Athens, everyone fucking knows.
Give your email address.
Doug@dougstanhope.com. Or just go to the website and hit the business email contact. That's the same thing.
Hey, by the way, if you go to DougStanhope.com, the June and August dates are now up, and they'll be adding to those.
All right. Well, either we'll come back drunk at the end of this if we come think of stuff and have time to do it, or we'll just play the Mattoid.
Party time. You've been listening to the Doug Stanhope Podcast, recorded in the green room at the Kansas City Improv with Doug Stanhope, James Inman, Bingo, and Greg Chaille. Recorded and edited by me, Greg Chaille. Opening music by Mishka Shubali. Party Time by the Mattoid. Both available on iTunes. Keep up with all of Doug's upcoming dates at DougStanhope.com. Thanks for listening.
And eat your eats, it's party time. Laugh your laughs and eat your eats, it's time. Smile your smiles and blue your blues, it's party time. Dance your dance and shoe your shoes, it's party time. Howl your howls and sock your socks, it's party time. Oh baby, crap your craps and fuck your fuck. Party time, hey!